Hi. I'm either pinch hitting for John Kaliski, if he's out there somewhere, or he was going to pinch hit for me. In any case, I think everybody figured it would be a great privilege to introduce Aaron to all of you who have no need to be introduced to Aaron because you're also familiar with him. But when I first met Aaron, I was immediately kind of struck by the kind of incredible scope of his interests. I hadn't ever met anyone who could speak with equal kind of enthusiasm about the Marlboro Man, the end of Sunset Boulevard, or the interior of an automobile, or a work of architecture, or food. They all seem to exist on the same kind of threshold of interest for Aaron, which, as anybody who knows him knows, that threshold is somewhere up in the stratosphere always. And if it's not, he'll yank it up there and sit next to it and somehow teach it how to be up there. So I think he's been an incredible influence on the city in which we all live. He's managed to make visible and popular all those things which we had, I think, kind of long ago consigned to the kind of obscurity that rare objects often get to be. And he's nevertheless brought them to the forefront. So we all already miss him down here. I hope he sends a little message down here. But I think this should indicate the beginning of a kind of rapprochement between San Francisco and Los Angeles. Maybe this is actually the first time anyone's come down here. That's true. You may be the first real emissary, kind of Marco Polo of architecture. Anyway, Aaron's here. He's going to speak to us about something fresh that I've never heard about before. And please welcome him. Big round.
Thank you. It's great to be back. SCI-Arc technology. It's great to be back and to have absolutely no responsibilities. And if anything goes wrong, it can go wrong, and who cares? And it already is. Can someone help me? Oh, wait. All right. It's also great because since I know this place, and since you all know me, and since, hopefully, if I make a fool of myself this evening, you'll remember the other times I made a fool of myself, I figured I can experiment. Since I'm always talking about experimental architecture, maybe I can talk about some experimental lecturing here. And that's especially important because, given the fact that I just started a new job, a new city, all those kind of things, I'm not nearly as far along as on this project as I hoped I would be when I agreed to give this lecture. So what I'm going to talk about tonight is going to be more or less a series of ideas, thoughts, suppositions, theories, notions that I'm trying to cobble together. And some of you who are in the queer space reading group or class that we had last year might recognize the ideas, their ideas, your ideas, wrapped up with a bunch of other stuff. And all I can do is thank you for letting me steal your ideas and hope I steal them well. But nothing I say tonight is really quite coordinated or coalesced yet. There's a kind of body of work that I've been working on that has to do with the body and sexuality that I'm wrapping all of this stuff around. Does this seem incredibly loud to all of you? Is it just to me? It feels like it's echoing. Maybe we can just turn it down a touch. Thank you, Keith. See, I've been watching people struggle for all these years, and I never quite knew how bad it could be. Anyhow, so I have this body of work, about the body and sexuality that that really started about 15 years ago when I got my first teaching job, which was teaching in the interior design department at the University of Cincinnati. And I walked into this classroom fresh out of school, 8 o'clock in the morning. This was when I was used to never getting up before 11. And I opened up the door, and there was 40 women dressed to the tilt, to the hilt, in stockings and full makeup, high heels, and one gay man. And they were in an interior design studio because they'd all gone to their guidance counselor and said, we want to be architects. And this being Ohio, the guidance counselor had said, oh, you mean interior decorators. And I looked at this and decided that something needed to be thought about this situation. And I started to think about how it is that we have a situation in our society in which gender, certain gender performances, certain ways that we behave as men or as women, and as what used to be called the third sex, is wrapped up with notions of space, with notions of building. And let me try and be a little bit more specific about what I mean by wrapped up. What I'm trying to get at with this work, which will first be out in a book called Building Sex that comes out this July, and then in another book which comes out next year, if I ever get my act together, called Queer Space, is the idea that sexuality and space are constructed together, that we make a place for ourselves in and through the means of building, that we build a place for ourselves, that we reconstruct ourselves, that we reproduce ourselves in space, in real, lived space. And every time I say this, it sounds very vague and abstract, and I don't mean it to be. What I'm trying to talk about is the fact that we make ourselves as real, experiencing, listening, hearing bodies in a real world through the way that we make spaces around ourselves, whether as designers or just as people who are making our own apartments. And that in so doing, we define ourselves, not in some intellectual, unknowable way. I'll leave that up to the shrinks to figure out what that is, but in a very concrete manner, that in the objects that we collect around ourselves, in the clothes that we wear, in the way that we speak, the language we use, in the way that we build an environment around ourselves, even in the way we choose cars, to quote Craig, we manage to define who we are. And I don't just mean sexually, I mean racially, I mean economically, and I mean a whole constellation of other ways in which we construct ourselves in the real world. And all of those constructions are so wrapped up together, so densely packed and layered, that we tend to separate them out into artificial categories. This is what I do as a professional. I build, I design. This is what I do as someone who presents him or herself in clothes. This is what I do when I'm in my job. I wear a certain kind of clothes. This is how I speak, because it's the way I've been taught. And what I've tried to do instead is to instead find a series of narratives that might find another way through the particular ways in which we construct ourselves in the world. And the one that I chose was sex. Sex because it's fun, sex because it seems rather fundamental, sex because it's something that for me in my life has been very problematic and intriguing, and sex because I think it offers a very clearly established narrative by which we can understand how we over time have come to construct ourselves in the real world, and how that those constructions reflect the exercise of power. And finally, how we might find within the exercise of that power the fissures, the contradictions that always occur when what you plan as your projection of power actually is realized in the world, the fissures that open up within there and might allow us the chance to actually make some changes. So what I'd like to do today is walk you through one part that I'm, if I haven't figured out yet, at least I've developed a spiel about it coherently enough that it appears in a book, and then offer some speculations on where that might lead, and finally offer some speculations for which I don't even have slides yet on what I think this all means. And that's going to be the really tricky part. So if I can ask the great slide meister up in the sky there to deliver us of the first two slides, we can start out. Gee, I wasn't expecting a murmur about that at SCI-Arc. It was. For those of you that were with me in Vienna, that capital of repressed sexuality, you might recognize some of these slides. So you can like go out and have a beer and come back in half an hour or so. The thesis of Building Sex, which is a book that I just finished, which is going to be out in July, is that the man-made environment is indeed made by men, and that women have had to make a place within that. And more than that, what we conceive of as architecture, what we conceive of as the making of significant buildings in our culture, is completely associated with male imagery, with the notions of erection, with notions of domination and male domination, with notions of an abstract and inhibited power. Whereas interiors in our society are wrapped up with notions of femininity and women. None of this is particular news. Many recent theoreticians, Beatrice Colomino, one of the most distinguished, Anne Berggren sitting right in the front row, have been talking about this for years. And so I just am trying to give it some pictures. I'm not saying either that men of necessity must make buildings and women must live in them and be sex objects, must be associated with sensuality because that's the way they are, as Camille Paglia would claim, but rather that these notions are constructed together. Martin Luther is famous for saying that men have broad shoulders and therefore they should work outdoors and make real constructions, whereas women have broad hips and so they should sit at home. That's still the level in which much architectural debate in this country functions. I think rather that we need to look at the whole constellation by which we call buildings erections and ask why that is, where we offer a premium to buildings that stand up tall and straight and by themselves, and tend to think of sensual interiors with layers of clothing as something not quite worthy of our attention, something perhaps even dirty, something to look at lasciviously. And we need to think about why that is. It's true, they don't work. This is I can't tell you how funny it is to like be sitting here and not wincing somewhere in the front row going, can't he point it out the goddamn things? Qualities that we associate with architecture as being good, in my mind, are rather strange. We talk at great length about the need for public space, and what we're talking about is kind of uniform, dead, empty, open spaces with no shelter. And this is supposed to be great. This is supposed to be meaningful. This is supposed to be about the common good. And then on the other hand, we talk about interiors as being fussy and messy and as being sort of guilty pleasures, places of dreams, and we talk about them as things that remind us of our youth, and Borges talks about it reminding him of his mother. And to me, it always struck me very strange that we talk about things in this manner, and it reinforces the notion that we have in our society come to this strange split of sexuality and art, and split between male sexuality associated with architecture and female sexuality associated with non-architecture. Of course, it goes back at least to the Renaissance, when certain theoreticians decided that the measure of all good architecture should be man, or rather a man, and it was taken to its furthest extreme. In the diagram you see on your right, one of the series of Vitruvian men that was produced in the 16th century to illustrate Vitruvius's text. You all know the famous one by Leonardo. Well, this was one in which the text seeks to explain that not only is this the Vitruvian man who squares a circle, but this is the Vitruvian male who impregnates the female circle of the world, the existing chaos, the fertile, unformed land, impregnates it with his power of geometry and divides it into a grid. And from that flows all architecture. And I would submit to you that most of our architecture today is still wrapped up in this. Keith, I really can't get these to work. I'm pointing them and everything. The other notion that we're, of course, bound up with completely in architecture is that we all must struggle against material, that we are seeking to free ourselves from the bounds of pre-existing tectonic reality, and that out of that we must form a more perfect, more clean, more abstract, more symmetrical body, and that we must use all of the tools of technology to research and understand that existing and sensual reality and grid it, control it, reform it into something much flatter, but something that implies another and more perfect world. I give up. I'm just going to say next, Keith. These things don't work. That more perfect world is one that exists in through a window, as Alberti said, through which one sees another reality, a reality that has no color, no shape, no form, only the perspectival system that overrides and controls everything. It is a world that leads to the creation of autonomous, absolute, completely freestanding objects, the same on all four sides, that internalize a perfect world and give nothing back except symbols of their power. Next. It is an architecture that of necessity is about raping and razing the city and all those who stand in the way. It is an architecture that cuts through the city, removing all of the dwellings that were once there, where people cooked, went to the bathroom, slept, talked, and replacing it with empty space, replacing it with the actual progression along which the perspectival order disappears off into infinity. It is a world that is infinite in its extension and scaleless in its overwhelming desire to completely recreate the world in a more perfect, more male environment. Next slide, please. The maleness of that world is so upsetting that it gets stuck in the slide projector, leaving me only with the image of prurient interest. Yes? No? Well, I'm sure you all know the image that I was going to show on the left. It's, of course, the famous Oikema by Ledoux. There it is. And it's worth remembering also for what I'm going to talk about, I hope, tentatively, a little later, what the story is of the Oikema. The Oikema was the centerpiece of an ideal city that Ledoux proposed first for the Montparnasse and then for a unknown site after the revolution. And this perfect city would be made up of these autonomous objects, completely controlled by a refined technology and ordered according to perspectival systems and accoutred with all of the columnar orders of which men such as Ledoux were so fond. But at the heart of it would not be a great church, would not be a great meeting hall or legislative palace, but would rather be this structure. And this structure was where you actually entered into the full rights of the community. For Ledoux, the perfect utopia, the perfect architectural world, the thing that all architects should aspire to, would be a place indeed where children and women were invisible, as they were in Greece, and where men controlled the objects that they had erected. And the controlling factor in this, at the heart of it, was the oikome. And when you were coming of age as a man, you would go in there, and there would be unknown women to service you so that you could prove that you were a man. And once you had entered into your masculinity through this rite, then you were allowed to be one of the people who were in control of this world. And to me, it's a perfect image of the way in which the myths of control and masculinity are wrapped up in our society. And the opposite, of course, is that are the hidden notebooks of Ledoux, one of the other members of the Kaufmann's triumvirate of the great utopian architects, who with great prurient interest redrew female sexual organs over and over again, and then created a cave-like architecture that was, if you will, the guilty conscience of the erections that he and his fellow Enlightenment men were proposing. Next slide, please. There is, of course, another side to this. Over 50% of the population, all during the great periods of architecture, which we study so assiduously, were, of course, women. And they were not living. It's just that until the 16th century, 17th century, we often didn't see them, or we only saw them as virgins or saints. But starting in the 17th century, another world emerges. It is a world of culture. It is a world, according to the great art historian Svetlana Alpers, where seeing is knowing is making, where the reality of experience, the reality of making and being able to produce and reproduce are represented all around one, and where art and architecture serves to mirror the world around you and to fix you in that world rather than to present you with another world. And this is a world of women that is not a world of sensuality necessarily. It is not a world of non-meaning. It is a world rather that offers a concrete alternative to the abstract orders men were inventing. Next slide, please. It was, of course, also a world that began to invade all of the grand and pompous structures that men created. Starting in the late 17th century, a certain, what I might retroactively call, queering of Baroque high-style architecture started to take place, as some recent historians have claimed, because of a certain queering of the court under the Dauphin, Louis XIV's son, but certainly under the simple realization that all of the great palaces that Louis XIV had decreed were in fact unlivable, and the king himself retreated into smaller chambers to hang out with his mistresses. And over time, a scaled down, more concrete, more layered set of decorations started to take over from the abstract orders of the palace. And we know today as a great progression of styles from Baroque to Rococo to neoclassicism. Next slide, please. And the very notion that one could have a style, that one could surround oneself with a particular reproduction of a coherent reality, and that one could use this to enculturate oneself, to make oneself at home in a newly created reality, stands in strong opposition to the orders, the abstract orders, timeless, classical, utopian, that existed on the outsides of such structures. Next slide, please. It was, of course, the mass-produced world of the interior, the mass-produced world of beds and chairs and wallpapers and wall hangings and knickknacks and bric-a-brac, all the stuff of the 19th century and of the 20th century that we often don't take seriously, but still with which we surround ourselves in our houses and our apartments, everywhere. It is a world in which fragments of sense are collaged together in a continually changing composition that completely overwhelms the architectural orders that it inhabits. Next slide, please. It is a world in which women rule supreme. Now, they ruled supreme only within this world. It was, indeed, as Henry James put it, a gilded cage. It was a place in which women were also imprisoned. It was a place in which women had a role to play. On the right, in this painting by J.J.J. Tissot, you can see the woman, late in the afternoon, reading the newspaper, the news from the outside world that she is not experiencing, while her husband is off somewhere, no doubt in a skyscraper covered with columns, working away, while she mirrors herself in the mirror, finds out about the outside, and watches over her children at play on rugs from India and Turkestan, and bears rugs from North America, which I guess is cut off on the slide, and with hangings from France, a whole collage of the world brought together and controlled and ordered as an answer to the emptiness of the world unseen outside of the windows. It was also a world, as one critic has put it, of artifactual literacy, where how you held a teacup and whether you knew your ancestors and how you picked up a spoon and whether it was the right spoon was a concrete way of making yourself at home in the world, more important often than language. Next slide, please. We, of course, believed that modernism was going to liberate us from all of this. Let's not forget that at the root of modernism is a refusal to accept the split between the abstract, timeless world of the outside, erected by men, and the stuffy, sensuous worlds of the inside. There is a refusal to accept the split between making, craft, and the kind of abstract planning with which architects engage. There was a refusal to accept the oppression that this split engendered. There was a refusal to accept the identification, class-wise, racial, and sexual, that architecture and interior design by the late 19th century had produced. It was an attempt to blow things up, to experiment, to try a world in which everything was movable, as the walls in the Schroeder house were. It was an attempt to discover the continuity of design as a critical answer to a world of differences, a world of oppressions, a world of role-playing. It's a house that's very important to me. When I was about 12 or 13 years old, I bicycled to this house because I was living about 5 miles away from it and had tea with Mrs. Schroeder. And in it, I discovered a world that was new, a world that I thought could liberate me from what I thought was an extremely oppressive society. And I think that ever since I visited this house, I've been trying to find something like it. Unfortunately, next slide, as we by now know, modernism turned out to be just another way of continuing the same gender and racial differences that are so effective in keeping an oppressive economy and social system going. Modern architects, no matter how utopian, as Beatrice Colomina has shown, reproduced all of the biases and all of the effective operational differences between men and women. Next slide, please. Not just in their utopias, but also in the way that women are pictured, even in Julia Schulman's sensitive portrayals of the case study houses. The case study houses, the last gasp of the belief that in fact architecture could be an experimental laboratory in which we could transform reality and with it social relations. Here, seen as a kind of abstract object, a spaceship to which the woman and her child trudge up through this burned out Garden of Eden to find themselves cantilevered out over this grid of technology, isolated in their little glass-enclosed gilded cage. Next slide, please. By the 1990s, of course, the frightening thing is that even this kind of a clarity of oppression is gone. All that is left in these horrific photographs by Joe Deal of Diamond Bar and the areas around there is a sense of complete absence of meaning, absence of space, absence of belonging, a sense that we live in a culture of paranoia made real through boxes of absence that give us absolutely no direction, whether as men or women or anything else. Next slide, please. And within that, those objects that should allow our bodies to extend themselves out into the real world and take control of space, those objects that might allow us to understand how things are made and might allow us to remake small spaces within ourselves, are instead mass-produced for us, are something to be admired, to be collected, to be bought at a furniture storeroom, and desperately we then try to make them our own, whereas in reality they just exist sort of floating in the great voids that our society has created for us. Next slide, please. It is against this, of course, that architecture has started to turn. And part of what I'm interested in is what I call a certain queering of modernism, when in the 1950s, the greatest weirdo of 20th century architecture made the final statement on Beinahe Nichts, on almost nothing. Mies, of course, had dreamed of everything disappearing into this abstract nothing in the glass house. He found that this was indeed no more than an ideal, a kind of discipline which could reduce man to a mechanism for production, for reproduction. But in fact, when he found the need to engage in some sort of sensual delight and to engage his body in the real world, he went down into the ground and created this vaulted bedchamber with no windows down the hill from the glass house to engage in his dalliances as well as in his nightly sleep, one imagines. Next slide, please. Of course, beyond such absurdities, there was a simple rediscovery in the 1960s that, in fact, we could make ourselves at home in the world, and that it was not necessary to pursue architecture all the way to the point of abstraction, that rather we could create ridiculous little moments of sense where we could find again our bodies at home within the framework established by architecture, that we could create saddlebags, that we could create hot tubs, that we could create draped and layered environments where the structure would reveal itself only to disappear again behind a series of theatrical stage fronts in which we could restage our lives within the world around us. Next slides, please. It was a discovery that decoration could be okay. It was a discovery that erections could be absurd and could be fun. It was the discovery that, in fact, one couldn't make sense out of the world, and therefore one should not try, but nor should one hide decoration, hide the reality of lived experience, but rather there was a possibility in the optimism of the 1960s of bringing the boudoir out, of exploding it out into a kind of sexual explosion in which it could take over even such bland buildings as the best warehouse. Next slide, please. There was and still is the belief that out of the fragments of modernism and postmodernism, out of pieces of history, we can create places where anyone can be at home, whether it's a film director on the left or a gay couple on the right, where all of the fragments of a world that otherwise might be meaningless can be assembled not through abstract order, but through a kind of sensuous and intuitive layering, a bricolage that allows us to be at home. Next slide, please. There is the realization, of course, that one can unbuild, that one can crack open, that one can reach down back into the body and into the psyche, and out of that create an oppositional fissure that will blow open the walls that separate inside from outside, men from women, and all the other other differences that have us locked up. Next slide, please. There is, in fact, more directly, the idea that we can attack within architecture itself some of the most fundamental propositions by which power operates in our society, that one can take the heart of the house, the hearth, the kitchen, in Peter Eisenman's House X on your left, and void it out and reassemble a construction that cannot even be lived, but poses rather the question of living, of producing, of reproducing. One can create an appliance house, as Ben Nicholson did, which is not a place to look at or use appliances, but which is a mediation on the unfolding of appliances as a technological text that questions what one does with appliances and who does what to whom with those appliances. Next slide, please. One can think, of course, as the house as something that must be restaged and rethought. And one can think even of the very notion of the primitive hut, the little pavilion in the middle of an Eden, of a park, as something that's no more than a scaffolding of mass-produced materials, which has no roof and no floor, and through which one enters only because, according to architectural graphic standards, men and women have different proportions. And if one follows those proportions and designs walls according to them, fissures and cracks open up that allow these walls to rotate so that one can actually enter into this spaceless pavilion. Next slide, please. The end, of course, of all of this, as some of the more interesting architects are leading to us, might indeed be the chance encounter of the sewing machine and the umbrella on the operating table. It might also be the transformation of ourselves into, as Donna Haraway has proposed, a cyborg. It is, in fact, a possibility that architecture today poses to us, that out of the collage of different objects, of different constructions, we can create something that is neither man nor woman, but that, in fact, might not even quite be human. Next slide, please. It is, however, stepping back from this that I sought to do a little bit more research, and this is where things turn very speculative. I used to end with that slide which shows the possibility that, as Foucault said, the very notion of humanity might be an idea that will be washed away by history, the way that sand washes away a name on the beach, written on a beach, or some wonderful poetic French statement like that. And that we might start to have to rethink the very notion of what it means to be human. What I've started meditating about since then is the possibility that one could be a little bit more concrete about what such a hybrid person might be. And it is that hybrid that I've used or appropriated the word queer for. And I do not want to imply that the only way to be is to be queer. And I don't mean to imply that queerness is necessarily a sexual condition. I'm proposing it merely as a convenient name for something that is odd and something that has a very concrete and sensual sexuality attached to it, and something that has also operated in our society for a number of years already as a concrete form of criticism against accepted norms of building and accepted norms of sexuality. And so I'm looking everywhere for a kind of queering, a process of queering, an active verb of queering, rather than a condition of being queer. I'm looking for the notion that, in fact, there could be a way of building a house that might be an invagination, as Derrida would put it, or that might indeed be a house, as Louis Bourgeois has proposed in her painting. I'm thinking that one indeed, it might not be so bad to plant some turf on Le Corbusier dead body, erect a nice Rococo fireplace, and put some chairs down and try to figure out where we are now. Next slide, please. Especially if you're looking out over the rooftops of Paris. I'm beginning to think that the strange and horrific images that show up in the nightmares of John Haydock and in the nightmares of Poe might find their way through an architecture of unbuilding, an architecture that refuses to accept erections and starts to pull them apart without negating or denying or turning away from the built reality itself, an unbuilding that might actually have a iconic quality to it. Next slide, please. I'm beginning to wonder whether, in fact, when people dove down into the sea-filled grottos of the late 17th century and found the seashells that gave the Rococo its name, they, in fact, did not find something that has a certain life to it. I'm even beginning to wonder, and maybe it's because I'm now living in San Francisco, whether we need not look a little bit more seriously at those incredibly successful, financially and if you talk to people who enjoy them, environments that interior decorators make and that we as designers often dismiss so lightly, whether there might not be something in all of the weirdness and sensuality and staginess and affected manner of the interiors that are created by people highly trained and highly intuitive that might offer an alternative to our too often failed attempts to create meaning through the medium of building. Next slide, please. I'm beginning to wonder whether, in fact, even within the strictures of modernism, there are certain queer notions that keep popping up, whether it's in the structures of someone like Philip Johnson or a couple of other bedrooms of some famous architects of the 1960s, in which, though following the strictures of modernism, there is something about them that has curved, deformed, moved, inserted a certain hidden light source, a certain movement beyond the confines of the whiteness of the wall that might implicate another place to be. Next slide, please. I'm beginning to wonder whether, in fact, there is not a narrative that looks up the ass of the symblegmata hanging up over Nigel Coates' restaurant, a narrative that is cinematic, a narrative that is ephemeral, a narrative that tells different and weird stories, that restages space in ways that is consumable, yes, commercial, perhaps, absurd, most definitely, trendy, probably, but also not only all of those things, but also, I would hope, in a certain way, critical by the mere fact that it refuses to accept the trap in which architects have found themselves when they try to recreate meaning in a world that has no need for such things. Next slide, please. I'm even beginning to wonder whether there is a possibility that drifting through the city, one can make oneself not only in the city, but as the city, that one can confuse the act of building and the act of self-making, of sexual self-making, within the same structure. Next slide, please. And I'm beginning to wonder whether, by looking at the work of certain artists, one might not find dangerous cracks and fissures, places that hide and open up, places that are drug-induced, sex-induced, under the pall of criminality and of death, through which, in fact, there might be another space opening up, a haunting space, an open space. Next slide, please. I'm beginning to wonder whether, in fact, we should not look at the work of some installation architects like Durham Kraut, who proposes that we need to collectively reconstruct memorials, memorials that are ways of re-seeing the world around us and concretely reconstructing it. I'm beginning to wonder whether or not the plague that most affects the effective elite of this country, that has worked its way most thoroughly into the culture industry of this country, its very effects might not produce the possibility of a criticism of the neo-utopian thought within with which both modernism and postmodernism are still so infected. Next slide, please. I'm beginning to wonder, in fact, whether it is not in the collage sleeping bag of a layered web of meanings that one might not find perhaps interesting architecture, and that whether through the forest of the city or the forest of memory, one might not find some queer acts that are an alternative to the erection of buildings that turn out to be nothing but speculative skyscrapers or useless houses for rich people. Now, beyond such wonderment, I really have not gotten very far. But I'd like to offer you, finally, my most speculative narrative of all. Can we get rid of these images, perhaps, and turn the lights on? And I'll just give you my latest, or just, I guess, leave it like this. Sorry. Either way, it doesn't really matter. I'm trying to erect a narrative that will finally, I hope, make sense out of all of this. And it's a little absurd and weird, so I'll take any comments you might have on this, but it goes a little bit like this. In prehistoric times, there was a locus of construction, of self-construction and of construction. And that locus was exactly the place where sexuality was defined. It was in the men's houses and the women's houses, in the places women went to menstruate, where men went to find their sexuality, where bonding took place, that the first pieces of an ordered architecture were created. It is also there where the first myths of sexuality were told, painted, and literally thus constructed. These were shared bodily buildings. They were split up into separate houses and huts. They were repressed and torn down. They were replaced by the empty and meaningless constructions of property, of ownership, of architecture, and of the dark, dank interior in which sex was for so many centuries locked up. What was repressed thus was not just a history of building and of storytelling, but bodies and communities a real shared spatiality, not public space, not private space, but real shared sexuality. Not good space, not correct space, not a space of liberation, certainly, not perhaps even a space that we would seek to replicate, but a very real and shared and sensual reality. That reality survived, repressed, throughout all of Western civilization as what Foucault has called heterotopias, as spatial conditions that give us our society back to ourselves in a mirrored and deformed manner, places of isolation behind threshold, places that appear only at moments of crisis, places that are artificial and self-consciously so, places of constraint and restraint and liberation, heterotopias. In our society, they generally take two forms. Either they are places of discipline, encampments, military encampments, prisons, monasteries, or they are places of sensuality, gymnasia, baths, bathrooms, later on tea rooms, rest houses, discos, party places. You might notice that all of these already start to have certain sexual connotation. They are where the sex that dare not speak its name often took place. They are places that are ephemeral, fashionable, often not very beautiful, but they are very real and very experienced. They are the image of our repressions, and they are the image of what we have repressed and might hope to revisit. They are also places that came into a particular mode of construction as what I call the guilty self-consciousness of the middle class. If the middle class, starting in the 18th century, had to create artificial places where it could define itself as a class, as an economic system, these particular places were the place of super or meta artificiality, places that comment on its own artificiality. These were places where one self-consciously played the role of the middle-class clerk, the middle-class enlightened human being, the well-dressed person who becomes a dandy, who drifts down the boulevard and becomes a cruiser, who creates an artificial community of the church of the bar, who must create a place in which one can buy in to whatever role one seeks to live out. In this century, that hidden world, that world that has infected our cities with real and lived spaces, came out of the closet and created some of the most viable communities. Let's not forget that it was the self-conscious need to create a community among gay men and women in this country that led the movement to reclaim our inner cities, a movement which led to gentrification and all kinds of horrible social consequences, but which also proposed a model for real community, however we might make fun of its bare brick walls, however we make fun of its self-conscious sentimentality. It is one of the few places where our society still creates a real spatial community, a community not of evangelical churches or of the internet, but an almost tribal space where people hang out together. Of course, there is a perversity to these kind of spaces, a sense of role-playing, a sense of dressing up, but also a sense of diving into the machine, of embracing the fact that technology is pulling us apart, recreating us into something that might not quite be human, a working through of the S&M of modernism into a new kind of space. Together, all of these movements create what I would call a satiric scene, working with Serlio's notion of the tragic scene of architecture, meaningful, and the comic scene of everyday lived experience, there is a third scene, a satiric scene, a mythic scene, a scene somewhat suburban, perhaps, a scene somewhat utopian, but also a scene of fashion, of style, a scene where you can be something else. Specifically, in our century, I think, architecture and interior design have merged into the creation of public spaces, baths and clubs, and cruising places, and places that infect our culture in stage, on video, in movies, in some of the most vital ways. I'm proud to be queer, and I'm proud to be part of a society that can accept such intrusions on its accepted norms. But I hope that it's not just a question of queerness as a sexuality, and I hope that it's not just a question of creating fun stuff. I hope that this particular memory, these particular heterotopias, these particular roles, these particular weird, deformed, open spaces might crack open all of the divisions that separate us and might provide a criticism, might create a realm of desire that might not be good or bad, but might offer us a break, an opening through a world of oppression. Thank you. I think questions often don't seem to work in this space, as I remember. I'll be glad to take them unless people want to talk informally afterwards. Let's talk informally afterwards.